In there stepped a stately raven.
Subject. This is Mr. Magnificent.
What?
Stargazer of the galaxy. The hawk of the horoscope.
Oh, oh, oh.
The pharaoh of the far out.
The pharaoh.
His majesty of the mystics.
Oh.
You do the receiving, and I transmit the messages and thought waves to those who comprehend with compassion.
Compassion. Oh, kiss him, kiss him.
Meditate with me now as I get into the super vibrations of my psychic mind, all three eyes. Our live guest in the studio tonight was born under the sign of Leo.
Oh.
And was born on August 17th, 1903.
Oh.
Oldie but goodie.
Oh, he's as old as I am.
The fortunate soul about to be interviewed by Mr. Magnificent is... Mr. Anonymous.
You know, Mr. Magnificent, I've always been skeptical about mind readers and the like.
Oh, really?
So you've got to convince me tonight.
All right, that's one of the reasons I invited you, Mr. Anonymous. I can't give you background because I'm sure everybody out there would know who you are. After all, the FBI does get around, even though J. Edgar Hoover doesn't get on TV too much. Mr. Anonymous, have I talked to you before you went on the air?
No, sir.
Ask me any questions you want. Personal, anything.
How many children do I have?
How many children? Like an echo in there. Nine.
You're right.
Wow.
How many of my nine children are boys and girls?
You have four daughters and five sons, four and five.
Yes, that's right.
Right again. Oh.
It's hard to be humble.
How many of my nine children are married?
How many?
Oh, he gets this.
All nine.
You're right.
Oh.
Make
You're beginning
him tough.
To convince me.
Good, make him tough.
All right. What city do I live in?
You have 30 grandchildren. And you live in Sharon, Pennsylvania.
Right again.
Oh,
oh, oh, it's magnificent.
One more question.
What street do I live on? What's the name of the street?
Stanbaugh Avenue.
Right. How about the address?
37.
Oh, you've convinced me.
Now, wait.
How do you do that?
I want you to know that there's nothing special about my magical powers. I have magical turbans. Now,
magical
if you
turbans.
Ever tried to read brain, mind, waver, and all that, you've never done that, right? I'm going to
no.
give you a magic turban, Mr. Anonymous. Put this on. I have to place it, though. You can't. It's my...
You mean if I put that silly thing on my head that I'll be able
you
to
have...
read your mind?
Don't you feel the vibrations already?
Yeah, I have a strange feeling
All
of
right.
some kind, but what it is, I don't know.
I'm going to ask you some questions now, and you'll probably be able to answer them. Personal question. Am I married?
Yes, you're married.
Do I have any children?
Yes, you have three children.
How many boys and girls?
Let's see. It's coming. Two girls and one boy.
See, anybody has that power. So, but we have to move along, and my name is Bill Cardille. Your name, sir?
Bill Cardille, Sr.
Oh, come on.
Yeah.
Well, nice seeing you, Dad. Oh, no wonder you're Mr. Magnificent. It's hard to be humble when you're so great.
Oh, yes, all right.
And to be silly like this again.
You'll never get me into this again.
Next time, you may be interviewed by Mr. Magnificent. Good luck to all of my subjects in the mighty... Masterful, Mr. Magnificent. Say, it's hard to be humble when you're so great.
It's hard to be humble when you're so
Mary, my pictures really turned out great.
Wow, you must have a big camera. Yours are bigger than mine.
It's not the camera. It's Sun Drug. They make them about a third larger.
Oh, keep your fingers off. They'll smear.
Don't worry. Sun Drug's new Super Silk color prints resist fingerprints and scratches.
They must have been expensive.
Not really. Sun Drug prices are lower than many places.
From now on, it's Sun Drug for me and my little camera.
It's a cool pool, a Pool City pool. Largest selections now at discount prices at all six Pool City locations for a cool pool. Cool in a Pool City pool. Largest selection available now at discount prices at all six Pool City locations. And keep cool.
Hello, I'm just picking up a few items for dinner, and I didn't even have to leave home. I did it with Family Food Service's Food Freezer Program. For as little as $16.97 a week, you get this heavy-duty freezer and USDA choice meats, poultry, seafood, vegetables, fruits, and juices. All top-quality food. Freezer owners pay less. You select the food you want. If you're living out of a supermarket, you're living in the past and paying too much. Call Family Food Service at 391-1484. What's going on here? It's the retailing business. Billions of dollars worth of the biggest business in America.
It's run by the youngest executives in the world. They buy, sell, and promote products people want.
Put yourself into the real action of business. Find out about the Wheeler Retailing School.
It's given exciting careers to countless young men and women. Wheeler is nationally accredited and approved for veterans.
Call or write the Wheeler School for a free brochure. Call now at 261-6848. What's going on here? It's the retailing business. Billions of dollars worth of the biggest business in America. It's run by the youngest executives in the world. They buy, sell, and promote products people want. Put yourself into the real action of business. Find out about the Wheeler Retailing School. It's given exciting careers to countless young men and women. Wheeler is nationally accredited and approved for veterans. Call or write the Wheeler School for a free brochure. Call now at 261-6848.
Answer the door, honey. All I ever do around here is work, 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 take care of the kids, take out the garbage. You answer the door.
Oh, big deal. Answer the door. Answer the door. All you do is take 3 a.m. Answer the door. Take care of the garbage. Take care of the... I do everything around. All right, already. Wait a minute. Boy, oh, boy. And look at the kids through my robe on the floor. Oh,
answer the door. Pick out the garbage.
Oh, wait a minute. Gee, 3 o'clock in the morning. All right. Gee. Who is it?
The Boston Strangler.
It's for you, Louise.
Fire, this is a time we're supposed to have a commercial about American heating, but let's not do one today. What do you say?
Who can?
We're not supposed to do a commercial, Pi.
I'm sorry, Bill, but every time you mention American heating, I instinctively say, who can? I guess it's an automatic reflex.
How long have you been with American heating, Pi?
Close to 20 years, Bill.
Wow. Have things changed much since you first went on television almost 2 decades ago?
In the very beginning, they only had live programming for a few hours a day, so we used a lot of slides. In those days of WDTV, Channel 3, the screen would show a slide of me while I talked off camera. We used the same slide every night. One time when transmission was particularly bad and reception was even worse, the picture of me on the screen had all faded. The next day everybody said to me, "Were you sick last night, Pi? Your face seemed so pale." Another time the slide came out dark and people remarked how sunburned I looked. I guess my health in those days varied with the way my picture came out on the screen.
That'll never happen on Channel 11. Pi, do you have any embarrassing moments on commercials?
I'll never forget the night when I was on camera for 1 minute and I never said a word.
Never said a word? What happened, Pi?
The director told me not to say anything until I heard a voice yell, "Who can?" Well, when the voice yelled, "Who can?" I couldn't hear it because the audio equipment had broken down. So while the voice kept yelling, "Who can?" which I never heard, I just stood there waiting for the signal to talk like the director had made me promise to do. And I think that was the first silent commercial on television.
Speaking of who can, Pi, how many times do you estimate you have said it in the past 20 years?
Let's see, approximately 6 times a week or about 300 times a year for almost 20 years. I'd say about 5,845 times, Bill.
What do you say, Pi, right now about making it 5,846?
Okay, Bill, who can?
American, American Heating Company.
But the kid wouldn't have it. He had to avenge the death of his parents. So he went after the desperados, and he said, "Well, before you go," he said, "I better teach you how to take care of yourself." And he did. He taught him how to do it very well. And now this is like 10 years later when we meet again. And there's a father-son relationship. There's a sort of a love-hate relationship because they're both two strong macho men. And a kind of relationship which... that Spencer and Spencer Tracy and Clark Gable had in Boomtown,
right.
You know, where they would...
Who is in the movie with you? Who plays some of the figures?
The young fellow who plays Nevada Smith is a I think a brilliant young actor. I think you've just latterly seen on, when they replayed the case of rape with Elizabeth Montgomery. Yes, and he was the rapist. He was the first to play the rapist. But he's a brilliant young actor by the name of Cliff Potts.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that he's going to become a very well-known actor in a very short time.
You are known for your visions. You had visions when you were doing news in Canada. Do you have any visions on this movie, Nevada Smith?
When you say vision, what do you mean?
Do you think perhaps it could run into an NBC series like you had with Bonanza and you playing the main character?
You know, in this business, anything can happen. We know that very well. Yes, I think it could make a very, very good series, and it's very possible that it will become a series. I hope it does become a series because I like the character. I like young Cliff Potts. I think he's great to work with. And I know that they have some great ideas if it does become a series. So we hope that your friends out there and my friends out there will watch Nevada Smith on the 26th of April and at 8 o'clock at night on this station. We hope that they will enjoy the show.
I'm sure they will. And, there's no doubt.
And perhaps we'll go back to Mexico and do a whole series.
Is this an MGM package?
Yes, MGM is producing it for NBC.
Lorne, you had a year sabbatical. Did you miss the daily routine, the working?
Well, I didn't at first. I decided that last year, 1974, was the year I was just going to take it easy. So I hadn't really taken it easy in 35 years. I was like you, working all the time. And enjoying it.
Busy, busy, busy.
Yeah, yeah. And so I just took time off. I did two things. I worked 10 weeks. I did played an Earthquake, the motion picture. And I did my animal series, The Last of the Wild, which is a syndicated show for General Electric. And I must say that Earthquake is doing very well at the box office.
Yes.
And my Last of the Wild series is doing extremely well around the country. I don't think it plays here in Pittsburgh.
No, I don't know anything about that show.
It's a great show.
Lorne, we're out of time, but if you had, in a minute, in a capsule, I'm a little prejudiced about this question because I have a daughter that's junior in drama at Carnegie, but if there were any advice you'd give to a youngster now, what would you say? Would you say, like, go to Broadway, try New York, live theater, go to the movies, do what you want, follow the wind? What? Is there any one thing you can say, or can you pinpoint it?
You can't say one thing. There's so many, many elements which go into the making of an actor, an actress. So many. First of all, study. Learn. Make your body the instrument. Your voice, your imagination. The way you think about things, observation, concentration, all these things have to be studied, have to be learned, to be able to concentrate on stage. Very important to communicate with people, to let yourself go, to be loose, to be easy, and then to be in the right place at the right time.
Right, to have it all and to be in the right place at the right time. Well, Vincent Price is in the back. He's on the projector radio with the Return of the Fly.
He was in the right place at the right time.
Right. Lori, thank you very, very
thank
much.
Thank you very much.
We'll be back with more of something else later. Watch this.
Good evening, all you tigers. This is Agent 99 with two frightening tales calculated to set your heart pounding. Oh, excuse me. Hello? Max. Max, would you please tell me before you say anything what I'm doing on this assignment? Well, I'm on this program, Chiller Theater. You're sorry about that. But Max, you really think the regular host is a member of Chaos? Oh, that's Chilly Billy. You really think he's dangerous, Max? Well, then maybe I could use some help. Right, Max, I'll be careful. Oh, sorry about that. In our first chiller tonight, you'll be terrified by the living dead as vampires stalk the night. And you'll want to hold on tight when you see the vampire's coffin, followed by a great Bela Lugosi chiller, The Ape Man.
The Egyptian sneezed while brushing his teeth.
His fleece was white as snow.
Agent 13.
Agent 99. What do you know about this character, Chilly Billy?
Oh, quite well, 99. Quite well. Not a bad fellow, really. Not really bad. Not good, but not bad. Why?
Is he dangerous?
No. He's not even a member of Chaos, either.
He's not?
No. The only thing that's chaos about him is his program.
Oh.
It usually ends up that way.
I see.
I'll tell you one thing, though, 99. You're in big, big trouble.
Why is that? Will he retaliate?
Well, you see, he doesn't like anyone else doing the show. He thinks he's a star. And he could retaliate.
He's in big trouble.
He's a rough customer, you know.
Right.
If I were you, I'd get out of here fast, but now.
Right, Agent 13.
But maybe we should change identities.
How are we going to do that?
Here's sweets. Lots of luck.
Oh, these new agents. The standards are going very low.
Some people say this story is false, but others say it's true. Fear not, old Ski King, 'cause, buddy, I believe in you. The sun was a-shining, the water, it was smooth. Ski King was in perfect form, Daddy-O was in the groove. Pink Cadillac came a-sliding in with a big boat on the rear. Ski King stepped out on the sand and said, the great Ski King is here. Ski King fastened on his skis, 50 horses were getting warm. The crowd let out a mighty roar, let's see that perfect form. He strutted to the water's edge, he waved back to the crowd. He pounded his chest like Tarzan would, and that made Daddy-O proud. Daddy-O backed up close to shore, the rope was a perfect throw. Ski King tied it around his arm and yelled, let her go, Daddy-O. Daddy-O opened that throttle wide, sounded like a swarm of bees. All of that power from the 50 horses made Ski King lose his skis. Like a porpoise up and down, they circled the lake about four or five times. Daddy-O never looked around. Daddy-O was driving that boat, Ski King was drinking the lake. People were yelling at Daddy-O, stop the boat for goodness sake. Daddy-O finally stopped the boat, he pulled Ski King inside. Poor Ski King had plenty of water, but he sure had lost his pride. Now the moral of this story, keep your neck out of the noose. Be careful not to grab a hold of something you can't turn loose. Of something you can't turn loose. Of something you can't turn loose.
It's a question.
Something you can't turn loose. How's something you can't turn loose?
Mr. Crusher is back. The parties are going to start. Things are going to liven up in Pittsburgh again. And Crusher's going to be there to stay. I'm going to open up a saloon in Pittsburgh. And the first night I get that championship belt, we're all going to have a big party like only the Crusher can throw.
Crusher interview, Pittsburgh, for September 3rd.
I can just see it now. All my fans sitting in a saloon having a beer now, saying, "Oh, what's that Crusher up to? Who is that guy? What's Bruno standing next to him there?" Well, I'm glad you recognize Bruno. I was going by a store in Skid Row in Chicago the other day, when I said, "Look at there, there's Bruno sitting at a store." So I went into the store and bought Bruno with me so he could take a good look at him. Take a look at him. The face looks like Bruno, the ears look like Bruno, and the brain inside, the sawdust brain, is just like Bruno. And when I get done with him, I'm gonna take my claw hold. You remember the Crusher claw hold. I'm gonna stick it in his stomach, move a few spaghettis on his side and meatballs, go up in through that stomach, right up into the head. I'm gonna drag all that sawdust out of there. This Bruno caused me to leave Pittsburgh the last time I was there. Pittsburgh was my second home next to Milwaukee. I went for Pittsburgh better than anywhere. All the dolls go for Crusher there, whether they're 4 or 5 years old, 80 years old. Everybody likes the Crusher in Pittsburgh because they don't get a chance to see a real He-Man. Take a look. You didn't see the Crusher's 100 megaton arms for a long time. Take a look and you get that whole camera on them 100 megatons. Take a good look. I suppose about 1,000 dolls are fainting already. Don't give them too much. Pull back. I'll show a little mercy on them today. Crusher's coming back September 10th. I got the cigar store Indian, White Owl, or Goofy Eagle, or whatever his name is. But when I get done with Goofy Eagle or White Owl, whatever you call him, I'm going to stand him right in front of my saloon. I'm going to have that cigar store Indian standing right in front of the saloon there. And I'm going to stick a big cigar right in that big mouth of his. And he's going to stay there and keep his mouth shut because I heard he's been shooting off his mouth. I'll have him back on a reservation with the squaws knitting carpets or whatever else they do, knitting handbags with beads. Because that bum, when I get them, I'm wiping everybody out. Everybody's getting wiped out. The Crusher is in the best shape of his life. You can see the girlish figure I got right now, that small waistline. I drink the right kind of beer. In fact, I've really been training hard. I found a saloon with a bar about 200 feet long. I drink my beer on one end of that bar, and before it got down to my stomach, I'd be on the other end of that bar for my other beer. I drank that beer. Well, by the end of the night, I can tell you I was in great shape, and I found another bar even longer. So when I come to Pittsburgh, I know there's going to be a big crowd waiting at the airport right now. The band's going to be there, the beer's going to be there, the polo sauce's going to be there. But just take it easy. Wait for the celebration till after I beat this goofy Indian, and then when this goofy Bruno gets in the ring with me, and we can settle back to normal, we'll go right out with the Pittsburgh Pirates, settle the championship of the world, the Crusher, the heavyweight wrestling champion, Pittsburgh Pirates, the baseball champions. We're going to have a lot to celebrate, so don't feel so down in the dumps. Cheer up. The Crusher is back to stay.
Me, 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 ma, mi, mi, Figaro, 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 Figaro. I love myself.
Very interesting.
Television isn't always what it appears. In fact, a behind-the-scenes look at TV is often more entertaining than what goes on the screen. I can vouch for that on Chiller. But commercials, no matter how well rehearsed, many times provide the most headaches. Anything can go wrong to an announcer doing a live commercial. Not on tape, a live commercial. You can't stop, you must continue. Something usually happens, just for fun. Let's take a backstage look at a live TV commercial. I'm not ready to do the commercial. We got about 10. Give me, Carpenter, the union says it's all right. Give me this so I can straighten out the leg, will you? How's it look? Does it look straight? The chair looks all right?
Looks straight.
Looks like a good buy? Okay. Just give me 10-second cue whenever I'm ready to go on. I'll just... What? We're... Oh, hi. Hi. Are you looking for the buy of the year in fine traditional furniture? You'll find it at GYP. I mean GYP Furniture. Look at this beautiful, huh? Beautiful, clean, nice. It's Pittsburgh's oldest and most Pittsburgh's oldest GYP joint, I mean establishment. This fine chair, for instance, this fine antique chair would be perfect for any game room or den. And at only $349.89.
The 32nd
one. Or was that $433.76? $200 a week.
Thank you.
You caught me again.
Brings tears to the eyes.
Hi, sweets. Hi, Poopsie. This is marvelous Maurice the Matchmaker. Here again with tidbits of information for sobbing hearts everywhere. Excuse me. So refreshing. You know, it's so satisfying, sweets, to answer your postal pleas. Here is our first petitioner. Dear handsome swashbuckler, I work at a name withheld morgue. I'm in love with a stiff. I've had it hidden for over a year. What should I do? Signed, Frigid Fritz. Dear FF, you apparently prefer one-sided affairs. I suggest you change jobs. Oh dear, you're liable to get hung up. Oof. Take it easy, sweets. Oh, may we all drown together. Ooh, is that good? Dear wise one, my sweetie prefers staying home on Saturday nights to watch the magnificent one on Chiller Theater. I prefer other activities. Signed, Lonesome. Dear Lonesome, stop it. Just stop. Don't be greedy. You have your sweetie the other six nights. Remember the song. Saturday night is the loneliest night of the week. Whee! Makes the world spin a little faster. Our last person writes, Dear Swingin' Sweetie. Ooh, I like that. We three girls from Seton Hill are savagely mad about you. You should see the Saturday night struggle to snuggle close to you. Signed, Three Little Maids from School. Dear maids, don't fight, you silly savages. There's enough of Maurice for all of you. Just play your cards right, sweets.
You're watching Son of Frankenstein to be followed by Son of Dracula. Right now, here is Daughter of Chili.
I dreamed last night that I was a tiger in the jungle, but I was a big fat tiger, so a lion killed me. And then I was an elephant, a great big elephant. There wasn't anything I couldn't do, till they caught me and they brought me to a zoo. So I dreamed I was an alligator. Fuck it all. No, alligator. With a great big mouth and four very funny little legs, which are no good for dancing. So then I was a dancing bear, and I was doing my dancing where the bears dance. But I was sneezing, cause I was a dancing polar bear, and it was freezing. is a giraffe? I look so ridiculous, I wanted to laugh, but giraffes can't talk, so how can they laugh? Whoever saw a giraffe laugh? Then I woke up, and I was not a tiger or an elephant. I was not an alligator. Fuck it off! No, alligator. I was not a dancing bear or a tall giraffe. I was only me.
Because this time it's no disqualification, no time limit, and I feel I am not satisfied with that last bout. Therefore, I'm going to do my best not only to beat him, but beat him so good that maybe Mr. Ramos will leave Pittsburgh once and for all. Thank you very much.
Don't be misled by what Bruno Sammartino had. Rain or shine, he's at the end of his line, just like he was on the last match. The last match, he was defeated so badly, he knew the end was in sight. He jumped out of the ring, grabbed a chair, hit my man with all of his power and strength, but could not stop him with this chair. And then in a later part of the match, when he seen he was on the verge of defeat, he grabbed it again and jumped back in. My man, some way, just pushed him and was disqualified. It was the most disgraceful, most disgusting thing that ever happened in the annals and history of wrestling. But the prudent me, I had films made of it. I took it before the Worldwide Wrestling Federation and had Mr. Gildenberg, the president, to look at the film. He ordered a rematch. It was what I expected, but not what we deserved. We deserved the world's title, which we did not get. But we will get it in this match this time, I'll tell you. Because regardless of Bruno Sammartino and his friends, his commissioners, and everybody which have been so helpful to him, will not be able to, because Mr. Gildenberg will be sitting there at ringside with the prudent wild red berry to see that Bruno Sammartino can no longer get by with his disrespectful, disgraceful tactic which he has employed in his wrestling ring in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I'll tell you now, I will see, and so will Mr. Gildenberg, and the films have revealed that my man Ramos is rightfully the champion, and he will be when this match is over. So you come down there. There's no disqualification, no count out. There's no way in the world that Bruno Sammartino can walk out as heavyweight champion of the world. You will have a respectable champion when Bull Ramos meets Mr. Sammartino, and I'll tell you, rain or shine, this is the end of his line. Some of these old champions have a hard time of dying, but we're going to steal a casket on his career, because we're going to break all of his muscles, cartilage, vessel, attachment of his head, neck, shoulders, and arms are going to be abused, contused, maligned, shocked, and lacerated. We're going to paralyze, pulverize, terrorize, demoralize, eradicate, destroy, demolish, and drive him to the sudden despair and right through that mat, and that disrespectful, that disgraceful champion.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bill Cardile reporting once again from Platform 34B of the Pittsburgh subway system, affectionately known as... And tonight's report is a most pleasant one, as the Pittsburgh subway system...
Not that way.
That's not a rubber duck.
No. And you look familiar. Were you here last week?
I don't know. I've been here all week as far as I know.
Hello, Pete. Oh, glad. The low is going to be in the upper 30s. I'm happy to announce that the PSS is most gratified at the response to last Sunday's subway special of the Pittsburgh Steelers game at Three Rivers Stadium. Though the Steelers announced only 43,000 fans in attendance, the PSS records show that more than 63,000 patrons took advantage of the PSS Steelers special.
Hey, boy, did you call me?
No, I was calling Bruce.
Oh.
He's busy.
No. Yes. Where'd I get the subway to post 1810?
Post 1810 to the right.
The Russians are coming.
Yeah, they were here at 9 o'clock. We can't explain the 20,000 difference, but as we mentioned, that's the Steelers' problem. Our only regret is that thousands of you arrived on our last train that afternoon, Sunday, and were forced to troop through the Steelers' dressing room on the way to your seats. Chuck Noll was a bit miffed at that. Terry Bradshaw had trouble warming up his throwing arm because of all the confusion. Terry Hanratty has lodged an official complaint with the Pittsburgh subway system simply because one of you grabbed his seat on the Steeler bench. But all in all, the Steeler subway special was a rousing success, and you can look for it again at all Steeler home games this year. It was really something great. Just one word of warning.
We're all busy. What are you doing tonight, big boy?
Go to post 1810 down to the right.
Oh, he's no fun. He's busy too. You guys are just no fun.
Seating on the Steeler bench is limited these days, according to the PR man, Ed Kiley. And we cannot guarantee seats. Ed says he wouldn't save a seat for anyone. After all, Coach Noll has agreed to stand during all home games, but Bradshaw and Hanratty do need their rest.
I told you we'd work it out. Come on, honey.
I wonder if that's District Attorney Dugan. Hello? District Attorney Dugan, just a moment.
Oh, what happened in the good old days?
So remember, the PSS, today Pittsburgh, tomorrow the world. I'd rather switch than fight.
10 billion butterfly sneezes. Man, with his flaming pyre, has conquered the wayward breezes. Climbing to tranquility, far above the cloud, conceiving the heavens, clear of misty shroud. Tranquility, finding its real worth, conceiving the heavens, flourishing on earth.
Time is a charm. Good evening. This is Mr. Magnificent.
Howdy, Bob.
Stargazer of the galaxy.
Oh, I'm a geezer of the galaxy myself.
The hawk of the horoscopes.
Hawk.
His majesty of the mystics.
Mercy.
The pharaoh of the far outs.
There's two of us here.
You do the receiving, and I transmit the messages.
Broken down mailman.
To all those of you who comprehend with compassion.
Postage due on that one.
Meditate with me now as I get into the super vibrations of my psychic mind.
Where was you, psyche?
There he goes. Enters through the wallet.
Our call tonight goes to someone born under the sign of...
Tell us.
Scorpio!
Him again!
He's a big crab.
And was born on November 5th, 1933.
Oldie but moldy.
The fortunate individual now about to be called by Mr. Magnificent is...
Sounds like Myron Davis.
No, he's too horny.
I forgot. Oh, it came. Frank Sebold
in Kittanning, Pennsylvania.
Hey. Oh, Frank, I know Frank.
Good evening, Frank Siebold in Kittanning.
Is this really Mr. Magnificent?
On the phone.
Wait a minute. Ken, wife, come here. I'm talking to Mr. Magnificent.
No, I don't want to talk to your wife, Mr. Siebold. Is it all right if I call you Frank?
Yeah, that's all right, Mr. Magnificent.
Frank, I want to talk to you. You were born under the sign of Scorpio.
Hey, that's a sign of love.
I do.
You know, I went to a fortune
now, teller. Now, wait, Frank. I do the talking. I'm the transmitter. Your moon was in Gemini, you know, when you were born.
My moon was where?
In Gemini.
Well, yeah, what's that mean?
What?
What does that mean?
That means that you're working under two signs.
Yeah, one of them's gone, the other one just came.
Yeah, Gemini and Gemini.
I hope so.
Are you ready, Frank, for a reading? And if you are, what kind of a reading can I give you?
Reading on love.
Love.
Love, that's what I like.
Are you a romanticist, Frank?
Oh, I love it.
Okay, Frank. I'm going to get into my super female voice as I transvestite through the airwaves.
Oh,
are you one of them kind?
Listen, Frank. Comprehend with compassion.
I'm holding hands.
Here it comes, Frank.
It feels good.
You don't know? You're just about to find out. How much love can you handle? You find that out, too. This is the real thing. And it isn't maybe time, it's yes or it's no, whatever the question might be. The truth is, the decision will probably be his, especially if he's really in a fever. Remember, his key word is passion, and everything he does will be very hot or very cold. This is not a neutral native. Never fool with his dignity, and if you decide to walk, do it gracefully. He's the world's worst enemy. If Scorpio is what you want, put away your autograph book, your roller skates, and your bubble gum. You're a big girl now.
Well, Frank, you're a big girl now. Did you put away your roller skates, bubble gum, and all that other stuff?
Well, I did tonight, Jill, but we're going to stay up late and watch your show. We never miss your show. We stay up till 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, Frank, that's wonderful. Would you say how accurate I was? What kind of a percentage would you give, Mr.
Oh, 99 and 99 100.
Oh, Frank.
It was just wonderful.
And so are you, and my best to you and the missus.
Oh, thank you very much, Mr. Magnificent.
Thank you, Frank Siebold in Kittanning, Pennsylvania.
Night-night.
Night-night. It's infectious.
99%. Oh,
It's getting better.
Next week, you may be called by Mr. Magnificent.
Oh, hope not.
Good luck to all of my subjects.
Good luck to you too, buddy.
From the mighty, masterful Mr. Magnificent. It's hard to be humble when you're so great.
Hey, where are you working next week?
Where is he working this week? He flunked this week.
You're not putting this thing on the air, are you? Who does your shirt?
Why?
How'd you do that female voice?
Delivers your light this way.
Oh. Like I seen your clothes down the locker room.
You guys know John Farrenkropf, you know the name? Isn't that
how you doing?
He's the guy that took me to
see you back at
the
time.
Thank
you.
I said, Jesus.
You got that?
Christ.
Here we go.
They played the U.S. What am I in? And I busted bar.
Get out of here. This is Stefan.
Thank you.
Here we go.
Who?
Stefan.
Sit up, for Christ's sakes.
Doing my best. I have your suit cleaned and pressed when I leave. Room 307?
Oh, you're getting funny. Huh?
Chilly Billy and Toulouse and I. Well, I'll let them tell you because it's really terrific. Pittsburgh, here we come again.
What Jerry is trying to say is that come this Labor Day, Sunday night, August 31st, we're going to have the biggest, most spectacular Jerry Lewis telethon of all time. So remember, right here on Channel 11, stay up with us, even if you miss a little.
You miss a lot.
You do.
That's terrific. I want to thank the Academy for this award.
I'm the first talking with Oscar.
Let him sign this for you, Steve. Thanks, Jerry.
About 4 or 5 men and a couple dogs. There's a house over here behind those trees. We want to go check it out.
Thank you. Go here, Bill.
Yeah, Chief. We're going to stay with it till we meet up with the National Guard.
Where'd you get the coffee?
One of the volunteers. You're doing all the work. You take it.
Thank you. We should be wrapped up here about 3 or 4 more hours. We'll probably get into Willard then. I guess you can go over there and meet the National Guard. Nick, you and the rest of these men want to come with me?
Well, Bill, let's check in the office, see what's happening.
All right, Steve. Tell them we're going to stay with it and... Everything appears to be under control.
What's happening? What's happening?
There are two of them out there. Have you seen any more around here? I can take care of those two.
I don't know.
I know you're afraid, but we have to...
I don't know! I don't know! What's happening?
Now.
Bradenton, Florida, named after a wonderful old friend of yours. And you're working hard with the team, but I'm sure we want to take time out. One of your most faithful fans, Ringside Rosie, has been recovering from some very severe surgery and illness, and I think we'll be looking in, so we wish her the best.
Well, I was glad to hear that she's recovering, Red, because everybody likes Ringside Rosie. And she was probably the first woman I ever met that came to a wrestling match, and everybody thought that she was on the payroll, but she wasn't. She liked wrestling, and she's a devout fan, and she's a wonderful woman. And everybody likes her, everybody that ever met her, because she's a jolly character, and I just hope that she gets back there where she can come up there to Channel 11 and also the arena and be for those wrestlers.
See, Rosie, you get the best thinking about you here. Now, we always have optimism in the spring. Before we start this workout, how do you like this Pirate squad of 69?
Well, they got some young fellas here, like Hefner, who's will be back in a couple of days, and also that boy from down in Cumberland, Maryland.
Robertson.
Robertson, the boy that can has got power. He hits balls over the fence 400 feet. So he's a long ball hitter, and he's always hit. And once you get a fella that always hit, nobody's ever going to stop him. And this is the first year he's been healthy, and he's 21 years old. Hefner's a young fella, has got power. Our catcher Sanguine looks like a fella, too, that's got that added power. So we got three fellas this year that's got some power that's going to hit that lineup. If Allie could only get himself ready to come back, that'd be a great break for this ball club. We're trying to teach little Freddie Paytack something. Freddie is a fellow who used to hit bad balls and a first ball hitter. Now he's changing his motive. Yesterday, he got a hit with two strikes on him. That'll give him confidence. I remember last year, Freddie would walk up to the plate, and after the two men will walk, he would take and hit a bad ball and might hit into a double play. He's going to overcome that because I'm on him all the time to keep away from that, and so is everybody else. And yesterday he started us off to get the first run by hitting a 3-2 pitch and getting a base hit. I don't know when he's been 3-2 as long as he's been with Pittsburgh last year until now.
Well, they always have the young fellows here listening to people like Pye Trainer, and that improves ball players and makes them good players. Pye just told you about some of the exciting new names that you'll see with the Pirates. Thank you very much, Pye.
You're entirely welcome, Red. Glad to see you down here and glad to give that kindest regards to Ringside Rosie.
Good.